For joining us today, I'm Susan Wright. I'm the coordinator of the San Mateo County Energy Watch program. And I wanted to thank Kara Gross, who's been instrumental in getting us all here today. Don't restart.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
I was just saying, Kara, helping us smooth out all the kinks here. Kara's with Joint Venture, and we're partnering with them to host this workshop today. And I also want to thank the Sobrato Center for Nonprofits for letting us use this beautiful new space. A few housekeeping issues, the bathrooms. You could go out these doors and through this little room and down the hall, and they're on the left. So, first I just want to explain, so I mentioned I'm coordinator of San Mateo County Energy Watch, and we are a partnership with PG&E and the City and County Association of Governments of San Mateo County. And we provide free energy efficiency services, such as audits and technical assistance and special incentives. For in the past, it's always just been cities and nonprofits, but starting in 2013, we are going to be helping out schools as well. We're going to be doing a big benchmarking project for all of the public schools. So we're launching into this area, and it was as we began this work that we were seeing how important it is for schools and cities to know about and understand energy management systems. And so that's where we decided to put together this workshop today. Just to, I hope everyone got an agenda. To give you a preview of this, we thought we'd start with the lay of the land, of understanding why you would need one. And so Napalo Gomez-Summer from PG&E is here to explain about rates and time during pricing and how this really leads you to want one, or many, depending on the situation. And then Phil Boutel, who is the energy engineer from Ecology Action, is going to explain more about the Energy Management Systems 101, giving an overview of the different things to be considering. Then we're going to have a panel of industry experts. And rather than this being a series of commercials of, you know, here's what we do, we wanted to really make this a sort of a problem solving and advice giving session. So more of a series of questions to help you really understand what you need to be considering for your own facilities when thinking about an energy management system. And so they'll be over here. And so I'm glad to see that most of you are on this side of the room. So we're kind of gonna, it works better to have you be able to see them all here. Then we'll break for lunch. And that will be a time that you can have a lot of open time so that you can go and talk to these various industry experts and ask them individual questions. So we're going to have tables set up over here. Each person can have a table, and you can have some informal time to do that. We'll come back afterward, and then we have a second panel, which is customers, folks from schools and cities, or counties actually in this case, who have incorporated energy management systems in the recent past, and they're going to be talking about why they chose what they did, how they, you know, what their decision-making process was, how they convinced other people, this sort of thing. So we'll have that, and then we should be done right around 1:30, and so if you need to leave, great, but if you want to stick around, there'll be a little bit more time that the experts will stick around for more questions too. So I will now turn things over to Napalo from PG&E.
Is the slide advance up here? Fantastic. Okay, folks, good morning. My name is Napalo. I'm an account manager for PG&E. And just by a quick show of hands, who we have in the audience that are facilities managers? Four?
Sorry.
Five? Six? Okay, excellent. So, EMS systems are, you know, targeted towards you folks. Do we have any chief business officers from any districts or anybody that's kind of on the financial side of things? No? Okay. Well, the topics that I'm digging into, decoupling and rates, what I'm going to do to keep it very simple and sweet is to show a couple of vignettes in an effort to demystify what is really a complex subject. And then what I'll also be talking about are some policy drivers. So I look to kind of lay the foundation for what's going to be an in-depth talk about the benefits of energy management systems.
So what I'm going to do here is queue up these videos real quick. And they're 2 minutes each. And they're professionally done.
First, decoupling seems a bit weird. Usually in business, the more stuff you sell, the more money you make, right? Well, decoupling is different. It's a policy enacted by the contributing to this success. And over the past 30 years, PG&E's customer energy efficiency programs have helped to eliminate the need to build 24 new power plants, helping California become more energy independent. Thanks for watching these videos. Making a few small changes in your home and in the way you manage your energy can make a big difference to your bill and to California.
Right. I always like to show that at the beginning because one of my primary
jobs is promoting energy efficiency programs. And there's a lot of financial resources put forward to these programs. I think it's really important to understand that from the utility perspective here in California, there is no incentive to sell people more power. There is a series of incentives to curtail that use. And an energy management system is really getting to a sophisticated level of being able to do that on a much wider scale.
This next vignette is also a couple of minutes, and this is getting into the topic of rates. Samir, do you want me behind the microphone?
You're fine.
You can hear me okay? Okay,
yeah.
Excellent. And this gets into an even more complex topic, which is rates. But again, this is, I think, short and sweet. And during the Q&A component, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try and answer them.
Standing your electricity charges is the first step to getting them under control. One of the most important factors that affects your bill is your rate, or the price you pay for a unit of electricity. Let's look closer and understand your electricity charges. There are three primary parts. Generation, which accounts for about 50% of your total electric charges. Transmission and distribution, which usually accounts for about 40%. And state-approved public purpose programs and a few other costs that represent the remaining 10%. Let's start with generation. Electricity can be produced from a variety of sources, like a generating plant fueled with natural gas, a solar farm, hydro, nuclear, or a wind source. Together, this makes up the generation portion of your rate. PG&E produces some electricity itself, but it buys most of it from other producers. So a major part of PG&E's job is to get that electricity to your home or business by delivering it from where it's produced to where it's used, your home or business. Getting that energy to you with pipelines and wires is the transmission and distribution part of your rate. Then there are public purpose programs and other fees. This part of your rate goes towards programs that encourage energy conservation, like rebates for efficient appliances, and gives assistance to special customer groups, like income-qualified customers on the CARE program. Now that you know more about a rate and what it's made up of, it should be easier to understand your monthly bill.
Everybody got it? That's easy? Understand the bill? I like showing those because I think it gets the topic nailed down pretty good from a higher level view.
So, everybody understand how the rates are negotiated now?
Yeah.
More or less? All right. What I hope to achieve here is to get everybody thinking of how these three elements come together, from decoupling to our rate negotiation, which is ongoing with the CPUC, and the policy drivers that are moving all this forward. I chose this graph here to illustrate the changes over time
for procurement costs. So just so we understand the terms here, system bundled average electric rates, this means both the commodity electricity and the transmission and distribution costs, okay? Procurement costs are rising, and that's primarily a result of the renewable portfolio standard and having to bring on more renewable resources into the electricity portfolio. That's the forecast in 2013. The simple takeaway is that the cost per kilowatt hour of electricity is rising. Now, we're working really hard to keep those rates affordable in the face of the policy drivers. It's going to present a significant challenge. In getting a little deeper into the weeds here, the regulators are working to try and curtail peak demand. And does everybody understand what peak demand is? Yes? Okay. Anybody know? Peak demand?
It's from 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock.
Typically 12 to 6, yeah. Yeah, essentially it's when we need to fire up expensive peaker power plants, which is the most expensive electricity, which trickles down to us as customers, meaning a higher rate of electricity overall that we pay if we have to keep firing up these peaker plants. This is what's fascinating, is that only a quarter percent of our overall electric capacity is used 10% of the time. Regulators, the Public Utilities Commission, realized this, and so what they pushed through as a statewide decision is time-varying pricing. And that's an effort to curtail peak demand to allow us to incorporate as much cleaner electricity generation sources as possible, help us meet our greenhouse gas reduction goals as well. This is a new thing for smaller facilities. Typically, larger commercial customers have been on time of use optionally, and it's been an optional rate, but it's been more favorable from an economic perspective, but now it's becoming the default rate across the entire state. All this adds up to a need to manage energy consumption at a given building site throughout the day, and energy management systems allow us to get there much easier than if you didn't have a perspective into what was happening in real time. And this is the main policy driver. There's a few other pieces, but I wanted to touch on the Global Warming Solutions Act that is just now coming into its implementation stages. The main piece of this is going to be cap and trade and how that translates into extra revenue for cleaner generation sources. I mean, a lot of that is yet to be determined, but again, this is driving the development of renewable energy generation at a utility scale. And a lot of these utility scale developments are farther away from population centers, meaning that there are oftentimes transmission and distribution build outs that need to happen. If you recall the graph that I showed earlier on, those are contributing to fluctuation and challenges with keeping rates at a very affordable level. Oftentimes, what I hear is, why is there this new program? Why is there this program? All these programs are so confusing. I mean, we're essentially trying to be as proactive as possible to offer a suite of efficiency programs to meet different customer segments. That's really what it boils down to. I chose this to get us thinking about where we are going in the form of, from a consumer-customer standpoint, okay? This is the traditional model of electricity consumption, where we have production, we have our transmission and distribution system, and we have our homes and our businesses. But things are getting much more complex as more technology is integrated into the grid. More renewable energy generation comes into the grid at a larger part of our portfolio. We also have the deployment of more and more electric vehicles, which is going to create some demand and supply challenges as that penetration increases over the years. And then we've got some neat developments with utility scale storage and distributed storage. Now these two solutions are kind of looking into the future a little bit, but that's going to be, and I'll answer your question in just a bit, that's going to be an opportunity to help manage those peak energy costs. There's a lot of research and development on our side as well as third parties looking into what the potentials are of being able to incorporate some of the intermittent power supply from wind and solar. Do you have a question, sir?
Ties into where you are right now. How is the system set up? Transmission is always traditionally been one way.
Yes.
Let's say in a perfect world, a town, everybody in that town put solar on. Now you've got energy going the opposite direction.
That's an excellent question.
Is that where the distributed storage is, or?
Distributed storage could actually be at the point of generation. So it's a pretty costly item right now. It's a high premium on getting a kind of a lithium ion battery stack in your garage. There are some people that have done that. The ability to push excess energy onto the distribution system is possible, but in a hypothetical scenario where you have, let's just say, 75% of a community that all has rooftop solar, there's going to have to be significant enhancements to the current system to avoid voltage fluctuations that can essentially cause some serious safety issues.
And is PG&E planning for that?
There's a lot of folks that are focused on that issue, power quality and voltage fluctuations within the distribution infrastructure. I mean, where we're at right now, when you look at the data, solar is roughly 1% of overall, that's on the residential side. You have 1% penetration, so it's still a very, very small number. There are concerns, just to be very, very clear, in communities that have a high level of fog, for example, such as Daly City or Pacifica, as those communities have a high, if they down the line have a higher volume of distributed generation systems, there is a concern of that voltage spike. It can go from very thick fog where you're not getting much electrical production to that fog clearing and all of a sudden having a pretty significant spike. And I'm not a power engineer, but I've sat on a bunch of meetings, so I kind of understand their concerns. Essentially going from nothing, one-way street this way, to boom, all this electricity going out. And electricity is going to go to the path of least resistance, so there's just some potential safety concerns. So that's an excellent question. And I guess I'm at the question point anyway, so it's
another question.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, where if you had distributed inputs from all these inverters, the PG&E, whoever's operating that piece of the grid, could see weather changes, could see the ramp up in voltage, because you can't dump your PVs when this comes up. But generators on the other end that do have some flex. But the time delays in this are not all the same.
That's an excellent point. From our perspective, the utility has a sophisticated team of people that do weather forecasting. I imagine that once we have that higher penetration of those systems, that's going to become a component of the weather forecast. Because right now, weather forecast is pretty much focused around if we have major heat waves or major storms coming in, how is that going to affect demand, the load overall, both gas and electricity, kind of looking 365 days out of the year. That's an excellent point that we're going to have to be looking at that. Over here, sir, and then back there.
So a lot of commercial facilities have got a cogen, like fuel cells or engines, or renewable like solar, PV, and if there is not that much demand, it's a distribution local demand in terms of net metering. We keep on hearing about this, being able to spin the meter backwards, get a credit, sell it back to PG&E. What's the latest?
So net energy metering is a statewide law that requires any facility, whether that's commercial or residential, to be metered for its production and consumption. Okay. And the tricky thing is the way the law is written right now is that the cost of electricity that is essentially supplied is subject to wholesale rates, not time of use rates. Okay. So that means essentially you're not incentive, there's not a financial incentive, a clear financial incentive to be producing excess capacity onto the grid. Okay. You will be metered for that, and there will be an annual credit, but it is not an economically wise thing to do right now. It makes sense if you can, you know, kind of net zero out your 365 days. Typically, that's a logistical challenge from, you know, the site orientation, from site to site. What we usually see is about 60 to 70% is the average of what people are able to offset with their solar PV system. And just to kind of mention that the cogeneration, that's a lot of larger commercial customers have cogen, and there's a different rate scenario for that based upon what their load requirements are and what the system generation size is. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, I'm basically talking about, you know, like a solar. If you're an office building on Saturday or holidays, you produce, let's say, 100 kW.
Yeah.
And your minimum load, base load on Saturday, Sunday is like 30 kW, 50 kW.
Right.
Unless you have a storage there,
then it doesn't really make economic sense. As I said, that generation is going onto the grid. It's being metered, and there's an annual true-up. I mean, not to get too deep in the weeds there, we can talk on the side. I wanted to get that gentleman's question in the back, sir.
Yeah, you just talked about time of use going from larger commercial customers down to just about everybody on the commercial side.
Yeah.
I have heard some rumors about going to a real-time pricing structure down the road. Any comments on that?
I don't have, that would be negotiation. I mean, essentially, that's going to come from the CPUC, the California Public Utilities Commission.
Okay.
And I wouldn't be surprised to see that. I know there's been a lot of interest in having a more dynamic electricity market to reflect the real cost, but yeah, I don't have that.
But not yet. And just one follow-up to that is, you showed that graph about rates with respect to the CPI?
Yes.
Any forecast, I mean, in the last 3 to 5 years with the renewable portfolio standard more coming into play, what do you anticipate from now over the next couple of years? Is there any way to kind of give an idea for people trying to budget their power bill?
I think it is extremely difficult to forecast rates. And before, a few years back, I was working with a solar company, and I know the forecast on the rates were very aggressive across the board.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's extremely difficult, considering the policy drivers on one side pushing for as much renewable generation capacity as possible to incorporate into California's electricity portfolio, right? And we're working real hard to keep those costs as affordable as possible. I mean, that's the best information that I have in its current format. So, yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, I don't have a better answer for you.
Wrap it up. But the follow-up has something to do, but Mark Johnson from PG&E will also be coming soon and will be available. So if people have individual questions, yes, thank you so much. Building health.
Thanks, Paula. That was great. Never seen those videos before. I always, when we were talking on the phone before this, I said I start the same way. I don't work for PG&E, but people always ask, like, why does PG&E want Amy to save energy? So I start with my own spiel, so it's great to see that you guys push the same thing. I find it really helps to find that actually, yes, PG&E has a financial interest in saving energy. So. My name's Phil. I'm an energy engineer at Ecology Action. We're a nonprofit energy company from Santa Cruz. We work, my specific role in this is that I work with Energy Watch programs. I work with San Mateo and Silicon Valley and sometimes Ambag down where I live. Our company provides both direct install, which is non-calculated type measures, deemed things such as lighting and other support retrofits. And we also support Energy Watch with engineering and calculated stuff, which is mostly what I do. currently working with, I think, four or five cities within San Mateo, with Susan's help and Kathy, our PG&E rep for the area, and basically working one at a time to go through and audit the facilities and see what we can do to save energy. And my role is not just as the auditor on the engineering stuff, but I go through and I come up with calculations to say, okay, here's what I think, where you can save money, and bring that to PG&E, and PG&E comes back with incentives, and PG&E pays incentives based on how much you actually save. Mm-hmm. So that's my role, is kind of to verify and calculate that number. And I'm going to talk about energy management, EMS systems, energy management systems in that context as far as what I do and see how we can apply to you. And mostly I'm thinking what I'm doing here is a lead-in to the panel of experts that we have here. And kind of to follow up what Susan said, they're experts, they're industry people. You know, we're not talking academic experts necessarily. They could be on the side, I don't know. But they're industry people, that, and that's how we know them, we brought them in. But we're trying to have them in the panel be here as, really the best in the industry to give you good advice, independent of the company, for at least the period of this panel. And then afterwards, when you talk to them on the side, that's fine. They can push their stuff, and you can pick your favorite or whatever you want. But that's where I'm headed with this. So what I'll go through, again, some basic bare bones. What is an EMS system? Why you guys as municipals, as schools, as governments, as nonprofits would need a system in your facilities? What can actually do for you, some specifics of where it can save? What you should look for when you're talking to these vendors and other vendors and what to do, and then I'm going to introduce the panel. So, I don't want to walk around, but I'm told to stay behind here. But anyway, so what is an EMS? In real basic terms, it's something that monitors, ideally monitors, but can control the energy you use in your facility. I listed five major users of energy, I include water up there, but there's all kinds of things that your facility could use, and an EMS system could monitor and control any of those things. Basically anything that can have a sensor, which is anything these days, you can plug a wire to it or do a wireless thing and see how much it's using, and then hopefully dictate how much that thing uses. There's a lot of other names out there you might have heard thrown around depending on a company or a person's perspective. There's a BMS, there's the BCS, the BAS. For the most part, I think they're all talking about the same thing, the same general concept. It's like something that you can actually get hands-on and control your device in the simplest terms, so that instead of going up and throwing switches on the wall at certain times of day, you can set a schedule and let the computer do it for you. I have seen systems like this out there in the field, and I'm sure some of the vendors can speak to this, and surprisingly, I'm always amazed that they work. They're a bear, of course, to get into or get any information from. The interface is horrible, but they work. The main components of an EMS, any sort of building EMS system, are the hardware, which there's a lot of considerations. It's a broad term. Hardware, there's your existing hardware, whatever it is you want to monitor or plug into. It could be a chiller, it could be a pump, it could be your lights. There's the hardware, like the control pieces that you're going to need to talk to your equipment. There's the sensors that you're going to plug in. There could be wires running from your equipment to those sensors. There could be some wireless transmitters at various spots. So there's a lot of hardware considerations. A lot of parts in there. Not that it's necessarily daunting, but there's parts. All that hardware needs to talk to something, so that's the software. And there's kind of the, I guess what I'll call the backbone of the system, like the communication protocol, which could be an open protocol, or it could be a proprietary protocol. There's the logic, which is whatever that backbone thing is running, so that could be, again, the scheduling of your lighting system, so it knows that this lighting in this room only goes on Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, assuming this room is used like that, or only at certain events that they pre-program in. It could be certain resets that are for your HVAC system, so that the computer is telling your HVAC system when it's outside, it's really hot outside, our water's got to be a lot colder to keep the building cold, or vice versa. When it's really cold, we just don't need to make as cold a water, so there's some sort of logic system in there. And lastly, there's the user interface. And these days, of course, if anybody shows you this and says this is what we're offering, you walk away from it, but nobody's coming to you. You want whatever system you have you want to be able to use it and you want to be able to access it, and you don't want to be intimidated by it. And again, the vendors are going to speak to this, I'm sure, but there's all kinds of stuff out there. There's things that are going to be a local computer parked there, but most things these days are also still web-based, and you can get it on your, you know, there's apps here. I really could access a lot of stuff on my smartphone and change temperatures and things like that. So come a long way in the last few years here on that interface. Why do you guys need one? As municipals, as schools, as public agencies, for one, you always want an optimized system, right? You want efficiency all over the place. That translates to a lot of things. Of course, money is the first one that comes to mind, but it spreads out to a lot of other places to have an optimized system. Everybody in the public sector is basically doing more or less. I mean, all over the places, it's not only the public, but everybody's getting budgets cut. You don't have the regular maintenance staff that you used to have. And an EMS system really allows you to do more with less. You can control, if you have maybe a campus facility, you can just control everything from a single spot on the computer. And not just the campus, it could be spread out over, you know, all over your city, or, you know, for example. So a lot of things you can do using fewer resources. Napalo mentioned AB32, and there's other stuff out there that are, you know, you're actually getting mandated. I don't know if there's hard penalties yet for those things, but they're coming. And so this is going to allow you to easier meet, and not just meet, but quantify those savings and prove that they're there to be. Maintenance is a big one. It's we don't talk about it as much in the context of the PG&E world because they're not going to give you an incentive for it. But really, at the end of the day, if you're maintaining equipment based on manufacturer schedule, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, sometimes you catch things. A lot of times it ends up being a reactive maintenance type of thing. Like, it goes and goes and goes, and you fix it when it breaks. And nobody likes to be in that emergency situation where it's summertime and your chiller just went out and you gotta buy a new one, and you really wanted that efficient one you've been dreaming about for a few years, and it's kind of in the budget down the road. But you're forced into buying a new one, which is available right now, and it's not as efficient. But if you would have been able to track the efficiency of that chiller over time and see why it's really degraded, it really, in the last 6 months, it really took a hit, you could have planned ahead and maybe seen that it would have been time to replace. And lastly, the one that's really hard to quantify is increased comfort. There's a city up here that we were talking to that, you know, they have four wings of their building, and of course there's north and south and upstairs and downstairs, and they said that every day it's just a battle because one person goes up to the thermostat, you know, single thermostat type thing. There's only one air temperature coming in through their ducts. And they go, and one person turns it up, and they walk by, and the next person comes up, and they turn it down, and the next person comes and turns it up from each of the three wings. And it's just all day long, it goes back and forth. And with that, everybody has a little fan at their desk, and a little space heater at their feet, and they have these huge bills. So some of the things you can get from installing an EMS, you'll be able to overcome that stuff. I have local controls. What can it do for you? Specific energy saving stuff. I'm so retro. Before I talk about retro commissioning, I'll read this ASHRAE definition of commissioning. A process of ensuring that systems are designed, installed, functionally tested, and capable of being operated and maintained to perform in conformity with the design intent. Kind of wordy. Basically, is the system working as it was designed? I think of it as not just as working as it was designed, because a lot of systems, when I'm talking HVAC here, you know, a system around here is designed to keep you cool on the hottest day of the year and keep you warm on the coldest day of the year. And then oftentimes the rest of the time in between those two extremes, which, you know, if you can infer from Napalo's graphs about the peak loading, you know, 8% of the time or something, on the cooling days at least, those systems are probably still cranking and making really cold water or really hot water or stuff. So that idea on retro commissioning, which is maybe a little stretch from the traditional definition, it's taking those things and just tuning everything down. All the times that you don't need your system to work at 100%, you turn it down to work at 80, to work at 50. And you can do that stuff without an EMS system, and it's labor intensive, and it's hard to quantify if you're doing it right. That for me is like the number one thing. Scheduling, that's often about lights, but it's also other stuff. It's your HVAC stuff too, which is, again, your primary user. occupancy, it can be based on, a lot of people have local controls for occupancy sensors for their lights or for their HVAC systems. But if you tie that stuff to an EMS, you can actually see trends over time and start to schedule around it as well. Additional dimming and tuning. This room, we've got a pretty good daylight coming in from that side. Not the best example, but a lot of things you can do with an EMS, again, not necessarily some big central thing, but maybe a more localized product, which again, maybe our vendors will talk to you, but where you can measure that daylight coming in and dim your lights accordingly. And it makes, my office is actually like that, and it's a fantastic place to work. It's not just, we save a lot of energy, but it's pretty awesome because the lights dim down just a little bit. You don't really notice unless you look up and notice that change when sun comes out, but really nice to work in. And again, I touched on maintenance. How you don't want to be doing maintenance as a reactive thing. You really want to maintain ahead of time. In the long run, it saves a lot of money in energy bills and equipment costs. Lastly, what to look for. EMS systems, there is no out of the box, this is our system, we're going to stick it on your building, and I hope it works. You know, everything's customizable. Everything is really made to fit your needs. The vendor's going to come in and look at what you have now, they're going to look at what you need, and everybody's going to be able to customize some sort of project to meet your needs right now. There's a lot of people ask about financial payback, and there's definitely no simple answer to that. You could get a system that pays back in 6 months, you could get a system that's 2 years, and you can get a system that's maybe 15 years. It's all, again, it's about what can that system do for you. That's a quantifiable thing that you can call the financial payback, and are there other things that are just as important? Is that, you know, are your employees not happy because they're using space heaters and fans and they're never comfortable? Things like that. But so whole range of that, and again, the vendors can talk about pricing. And I mentioned once before about user-friendly. I think it's crucial to have something that's important. Like Apollo, I came from the solar industry before this, and I used to talk about this on the same type of thing in solar monitoring systems. It's like, well, in a nutshell, they're all going to do the same thing, but really get the one that you like, that you do want to pull up on your phone, or like, that's so cool, you want to show people, look what I can do. Doing it all the time. And it's probably going to have most of the functionality that's there, but it's the user-friendly one that's going to encourage you to use it, and you're going to therefore get the benefit out of it. And with that, I'd like to introduce our panel of experts. So if people want to come up here, I can introduce you one by one. Start with Barry Service. You here? Never met Barry. Barry's not here. Okay, our panel's down to five. Phil Buckeridge, right here, from Environmental Systems. Thanks, Phil. And our panel, we're going to be up here. I'm going to join you guys down here. I have a mic that I'm hoping works. If not, we'll talk to you later. But, and okay, I'll keep going. Irma Kent from Sunbelt Controls. Hi, Irma. And Scott Wallace from Sizerco.
Excellent. All right. Mike Leslie, you here? I haven't met Mike either. Wayne from Tech 10. And Tim. Tim Sisson from Train. A lot of questions earlier, and it sounds like there's a lot of interest in this group. And if things slow down, I have a whole list of questions, too, that I can go from there. But anybody want to start out from the audience? And also, it's a bit informal. We haven't talked about the exact way to do it, but I think we're just going to rotate around. And the panelists all know they're not going to hog time or anything else. But if you have a burning answer that as a follow-up thing, you know, jump in. That's perfect. Yep.
Can you have the panel introduce themselves?
Yeah, it'd be great.
Hi, I'm Tim Sisson with Train. I've been doing this way too long. My focus is dealing directly with clients and not specifically products, so I should be able to help you today with pretty much everything.
Hi, I'm Mike Leslie with Tekton Incorporated. We are into the energy management systems here for as long as anybody else. We're in the wireless, we do wireless communications.
Yeah, hello, Scott Wallace from Sagico. And I've been in the energy management and energy efficiency business for about 16 years or so. And our focus is the allergen control system, and open protocol system, and energy efficiency.
My name is Irma Kemp, and I'm with Sunbelt Controls, and we provide energy management solutions as well as control systems. And we provide various different platforms, so we don't represent just one control system, but some closed, some open. So we have but really our focus is providing control solutions for you.
Hello, my name is Phil Backeridge, and I'm with Environmental Systems. I've been in the energy management controls business for, well, not as long as 10, but close. Two decades, actually. And we are a mechanical contractor and also a controls contractor, and we represent Delta Controls, which is a backward system.
So you guys mentioned open and you know, closed protocol and stuff like that. Can someone kind of explain what that means? BACnet, et cetera, Scott?
Sure, and in my past life, I'll just talk if you can hear me.
So I spent a big part of my life at Siemens, large company, and really back in, I'd say, pre-1995-ish, most building automation systems were proprietary. And so what did that mean? That meant when a system was installed in a building, it didn't really talk to a whole lot of different things other than through custom drivers. And it meant when a system was installed, the owner had very little flexibility. So you kind of had it and you're kind of married to that vendor and that product for quite a long period of time without spending a lot of money to replace it. ASHRAE came together and a few other standards, different protocols, came together in 1995 and came up with BACnet. And that was really a whole industry organization movement that said, wait a minute, that doesn't really make sense. Let's install products in buildings from a building automation system standpoint that will talk to everything and has a common language. And that gives the owner the maximum amount of flexibility to say, you know what, maybe this isn't working out. Let's have it either install, you know, talk to a different control system or even a different piece of equipment. So it's kind of a common language.
A really good example of that is Bluetooth, right? So you can go down the Verizon store and buy virtually any headset you want. They go with any phone. And that's pretty much where our industry is at. Lots of selections, lots of options. And for you as clients, what you're looking at is you have the ability, if you're not getting the service or the products that you want, you have the ability to change relatively affordable. And I'm going to be real careful with the relative word. Anybody else?
That's great. Any questions? Here we go.
So on that note, I'm sorry to put you on the spot, Tim. So we have a building that's about 10 years old. It has a Trane heating system. And I've been told it's very proprietary and only Trane people can work on it. So is that a difference between the actual boiler itself and the actual air conditioning unit itself versus the energy management system? Or do we just have a system that even though it's only 10 years old, wasn't exactly modern when we installed it?
Interestingly enough, that's a good lead-in. That you have to look at, two pieces to this. In general, you're going to be controlling or monitoring something, right? In my case, oftentimes it's air conditioning, that's true for all of us. And so that thing that you may be controlling may not have the appropriate interface for the energy management system that you have. And it may have an interface, but it may not be open. It may be a proprietary interface. Based upon time, and this would be true for trains, be true for all other major manufacturers, Train Carrier York, have huge product lines, and it actually takes us years to get our entire product, as we move to a protocol, it takes a long time for major manufacturers to get all those pieces of equipment up to the latest protocol. And just about the time we do, it changes. So you could be in a time situation of when you purchase that equipment versus being on an open or closed protocol.
Thanks.
And I'll talk to you directly about that if you'd like.
And I can add something.
You may also have the ability to add an interface module either to the equipment or to your control system that would allow you to communicate with whatever piece of equipment you want to communicate with.
So just as a follow-up, does that sound like if something has a proprietary system in it, it's not as, like, it's not a brick wall like it used to be because there's interfaces and things like that that could often overcome it?
Yeah,
with limitations. With limitations, sure. Okay. Any more audience questions right now? Yes. And you want to introduce yourself when you say a question?
I'm a plant. I wouldn't join it. So. Just a very general question on building control versus energy management. Because for a long time, it was about controlling air conditioning, controlling the lighting system. More and more people are now concerned about energy efficiency. So what's come along more recently relative to the energy management question? I mean, new capabilities that
you guys understand the question?
Can you repeat it for the camera?
Sure. He mentioned camera. it used to be called building controls, really. And lately it's been, people refer to it as energy management system. And maybe they do the same things, or maybe not. And so how have things changed so that it's become more of an energy management system instead of just a control system?
When it comes to energy management, some of the software companies have developed, there's a lot of companies out there that do energy management with software, and basically they just give you the tools and description of what you should do to the building to save energy, not necessarily have connected with the controls. Some of these new companies, the energy management systems, now that are coming on board, not only have the software and give you the tools to do it, but also the controls to actually implement that energy savings. So, you want to add something to that?
Sure. Yeah, and it's funny because I've been in many buildings that have a state-of-the-art modern energy management control system. I really use those names interchangeably. And you look at it, and they're not really saving a lot of energy, but kind of dig into it. And when those energy management systems are installed, typically you're following a design spec. And so that system will only be as efficient as that design spec specifies it be. And I'd say before, call it 5 or 6 years ago, there wasn't a whole lot of emphasis to make everything cutting edge efficient. Let's keep people comfortable, and that's it. And I'd say really, kind of, if you look back, call it since 1990, we really had probably three huge shifts in technology and what we all do. And I jump back to 1990, we're kind of shifting from pneumatic controls into the first early DDC, which was distributed, you had one machine, you could see what's going on in your building from one place versus pulling the ladder to every single room you had a problem. I'd say in about the late 90s, you had the advent of Batman, an open protocol, as I mentioned before, and also you had Ethernet. So all of a sudden you've got, you know, campuses being connected at super high speeds, connecting to everything, relatively inexpensively. And I'd say now as you look, just in this decade, last year or so, we've really shifted to true energy management, which is taking that control system and infusing PG&E rate tariffs, for example, forward-looking weather forecasts, and understanding the mass dynamics you're building. So you can start predicting, what's my load gonna be like tomorrow? Well, the PG&E rate, you know, in summer I've got peak pricing, that's gonna spike my bill. How do I plan for that? So I'd say that's truly, we're just getting into true energy management nowadays.
To add, there's so many tools available now in your EMS system, such as trending, that you get real-time data that will give you a really good analysis of what is going on in your building. And we have to remember that a building is not something that's static, it's constantly changing. And I think in the past, people have installed an EMS system, then they forget about it. And it's something that you constantly need to be looking at. Perhaps the number of employees that you have in the building has shifted. You've done some TI work and layout is different. All that will impact how much energy you use, how much energy you need, and it just, the tools have really evolved of what's available on your EMS system.
Yeah, also I think we tend to focus more on the entire building rather than just the HVAC system. Your energy management systems today can control your lights, monitor your water, control your irrigation, access, things like that. And really, it's just a matter of applying what you may already have now to include these other areas of energy consumption.
Just before I get more panel questions, just a quick follow-up to that, Phil. So you're saying that you could use one system and control all that stuff, as opposed to, I think, back in the day, it was really like, you have a lighting control system.
Right. Most systems have much more capability than that.
So answer yes. Okay, yes.
I just had a comment to follow up on this. Nowadays we call it EMCS, Energy Management Control System, like an EMCS upgrade or EMCS retrofit. So you can tie your gas, electric, water meters to your energy management system to pulse outputs. And in our facility, one of them what we're doing is demand management. So we're letting PG&E directly connect to our grid management system. And a day ahead or same day, they say, you know, between this and hour, it's out of curtailment time. So the system is pre-programmed to go to this demand level, so curtailment, and all the things happen, and then we reduce our peak demand.
Right. So what was your facility? Where are you from?
I'm with County San Mateo.
Okay, so County San Mateo. So just to say that again on the mic, what he says his EMS is capable of, PG&E now has an interface to his EMS, and when there's a peak day, a predictive peak day, they don't call it day, they call it the day before or a little before that and say, you know, on Thursday it's going to be a big day. And then PG&E actually has signals that control certain things and shed loads based on that predictive peak day so that they have a reduced bill. I'm sure you get incentivized for that type of thing too, so they help pay for the offset of the inconvenience of shedding those loads. So it's another thing the EMS can do. Yes?
So kind of following up on the comment about EMS systems require you constantly look at it and being able to be knowledgeable enough. So when you're talking with customers, how much time are you recommending that they actually spend managing their management system? And if you recommend a certain level of consulting on your side to do that on a consistent basis, what is that?
Okay, so the question, how much time do you recommend customers actually spend managing that EMS system, keeping up with it, as she's emphasizing how they all said, well, you have to keep going. It's not an install and walk away thing. Summarize.
And how much training, too?
How much training, and would they be required as vendors to come in and be consultants continually to provide that sort of training for their staff?
You know, I want to be careful with that. I think we'd have to look at is what's really going on inside your facility. We've been involved with systems that are process oriented, and they require virtually no management. If they're commissioned, back to the commissioning piece, if your automation system gets commissioned properly, your requirement for, and this is kind of the fix-it side of it, will diminish. Conversely, if you have a facility that's dynamic in use, well, then the automation system, you're constantly changing schedules, and your occupancy change and your use changes. So one of the things you have to really look at is what you want to do in your facility and what your facility, and what your ultimately what the goal of the mission of the facility is will really dictate that.
Some of the new software that we have set up is made so that it can be user friendly. The GUI interface, you want it so that it's not that complicated and you have to call in an engineer every time you have a change. We found that if it's too difficult to use, you won't use it. So the schedules are set up like in some of the systems I've seen, they're as easy as using Microsoft Outlook. And you predetermine what you want to do. You sit down, like Tim said, about commissioning being properly set up in the first place, and you interview the client and make sure that the building is working for the client along with the energy goals that you're trying to achieve. And you predetermine those. You can actually set up your auto DR response, exactly what do you want to turn off at the time there's a curtailment event. And you basically predetermine that, and you take some of the scheduling in the occupancy that you put together and take some of that human behavior back out of it so you can get the energy savings you're trying to achieve.
Yeah, just one short out of that. And I think probably the biggest factor, it's like anything else, you know, we work with clients anywhere from a school district where maybe the person managing the BMS has got, you know, 100 other duties, and this is one small fraction of what they do every week. Or you have, we have biotech facilities where you've got two or three people and their whole job every day is to manage that system. I think that's probably the biggest thing. How often are they touching that? And it's like anything else, it's human nature. I mean, you kind of forget what you're not doing on a regular basis. So depending on where in that spectrum your facilities team lies, you know, I'd recommend always some recurrent training is always good. Things, you know, things are very dynamic in general.
Yeah, I would say that most of the systems today are going towards a web-based interface. And so more and more when you access the system, it looks like any other web page you might go to. And I don't believe that the typical user needs the in-depth training, for example, on programming and things like that. You simply just pull up the web page and get familiar with what pages are connected to what parts of the building, and it's become fairly simple.
How is the dynamic of this system kind of changing as PG&E is starting to do more demand-side management programs, like he was talking about SmartEC programs? Like, is that kind of changing the interface and that dynamic between the actual facilities manager and the EMS system and PG&E? Is that shifting things?
Yeah, so repeating the question is, how is the dynamic of the system, like an EMS system, with PG&E changing with things like demand response and other things like that? Is that summarizing?
Yeah.
So what we're finding is that customers want to have a better understanding of where their energy usage is going. So we're seeing an increase in metering and tying that into your BMS. And I think that is being driven by PG&E and some of the changes that are happening in the industry. So they really want to know, okay, how are we spending our energy? Where is it going? And they want to have more control over it. And that's a great feature of the BMS system.
Here's one way to think about it. It's maybe going back to the 80s, where we used to traditionally do duty cycling. So a lot of what you heard about today is demand response and time of use. And I want to maybe put that in perspective. Going forward, Title 24, if you dig into the details, there is a piece that says now in the state of California, you cannot have, if you purchase a programmable thermostat, it must have remote communication capabilities. So that's the law. Okay, and I think, you know, if you understand, you can read between the lines about what's coming in the future, and that's part of why we're all here today. So an example of that would be, so you get your demand response signal from your utility, and oh gee, I have to respond. Well, what does that mean? Well, if you haven't met any of us and you don't have a building automation system, you may be running around with walkie-talkies and tennis shoes and clipboards and trying to figure out what's the right thing to do. And believe it or not, there are people who go through that drill. And then, so, or you can say, you know what, we're going to turn off this wing. And then you have the earlier conversation. So, you know, you're now being punished because your office happens to be on the wrong wing. Or you can selectively go through and say, we're going to turn off every other room. Or you can say, here's kind of the answer, is now the systems are sophisticated enough where you can slowly drop the temperature maybe 1 degree in every room. So it's that kind of dynamics. And then, you know, as moving forward with what kind of day it's going to be, what we talk to, maybe you only have to drop it down a half a degree. You know what your demand target is. And sophistication of the systems will actually keep the comfort that ultimately your occupants are looking for in check, versus it's all about energy.
And to speak more that beyond HVAC too, lighting is very similar. You can, I think PG&E at some certain workshops, they've said that you can dim lighting 10% and it's kind of imperceivable to the human eye. So that's an instant demand response event. It's just tune the lights just a little bit, you know, and then tune a little more if you need to. Got some more questions here. Yes.
Historically, one of the big costs for EMS, if you're starting from nothing, it's the infrastructure, the wiring, hard wiring to, for HVAC anyway, to the thermostats. And I'm just wondering how wireless is coming along here in terms of cost competitiveness. It's been very expensive, but you can see in school situations and many others where you have a lot of portable buildings and various distributed things, the hard wiring is the showstopper. So are there any things on the horizon?
Yeah, great question. So again, to repeat it, historically, the infrastructure cost to add an EMS, any sort of system like that, there's a lot of hard wiring costs involved. And how far has wireless come and what are the expenses these days? Has it come down significantly to be competitive? And, this example was in a school system, you might have modular buildings that change every few years. So who wants to go hardwire a bunch of stuff if you have some wireless so you can come with that? Mike.
So the question there, that's I kind of wanted to come back to his question, or her question on the technology sector and where energy management systems have arrived today and from the legacy controls that we've had, you know, through the years. And wireless is definitely the new kid on the block, 2003. I don't think any company has been in the wireless sector since before that. They've been in controls and management, but not in the wireless sector that I know of. And the wireless, putting wireless system in an existing building makes total sense from your green building perspective, your cost, you're not having to tear walls apart, put copper in. The installation cost is reduced immensely. And for modulars, especially schools, I know a lot of the schools, we've looked at a lot of schools, they have, every school in California has modular classrooms, and not a person on in the campus there can tell you what the energy consumption is of that building. There's no way to really track that. So they're without putting meters on and testing it up. We also, part of the new technology in energy management systems is plug load controls, which is also a new kid on the block. And the California Energy Commission has put more emphasis on that in the last year. That's kind of like that energy consumption pie. You see the 28% called other, and that's where we're actually going for with wireless plug load controls also.
Yeah, I would say I was one of the folks, at least at our company, on the bleeding edge of trying to implement wireless back in about 03. And I think it had a painful start, but I think it's pretty mature at this point. And I think the first thing when you start thinking about wireless is you got to fit the application correctly. I mean, there's good times to use wireless and not good times. You brought up the school portables. I think in that particular instance, we are doing a lot of work integrating those portables, whereas before, it was pretty much cost prohibitive to go out to some portable sitting in a parking lot and bring that in. Now with current technology, it's becoming more affordable. It's also becoming a great demand response play as well. We start looking at time of use rates going down to just about elementary schools, if not now in the very near future, and being able to bring in all the portables as part of that strategy is pretty helpful.
In your particular, I would agree with a lot of the comments that Scott has made, but in your particular case, there are some products out there, such as wireless pneumatic stats. It's almost like a hybrid DDC. So the cost to install those is significantly less than going to a full DDC system, but you have all the benefits of having a DDC system. And there's several good options out there.
Yes, I'd also like to add, we've also had some experience with wireless network routers as well. So if you have a building, a remote building, for example, you can actually get a communication protocol like BACnet or LongWorks or whatever it might be to that remote building through a wireless router now, which also reduces the cost. So we're thinking about not just the field device level wireless, but also the network itself.
I'll add one thing to this, and I'm not going to speak to the HVAC side of it because I'm not sure if they've done this, but I know in lighting, parallel to wireless, they have power line for AC, and so
where you don't actually have to put in wireless stuff, you don't have to put in Ethernet cables, you don't have to do any of that. You just plug in your controllers to your AC wiring, and that same AC wiring that talks to your lights, or that goes to the lights, and then it sends communication signals because they work at different frequencies, and there's things in the lights that can, in the ballast, that can actually hear those signals. So you can dim your lights without actually having to rewire or add wireless things. And again, I don't know if they're for HVAC. Usually it's a little more industrial than that. Solutions are out there. Yes?
I have a question particularly for Scott. I'm from San Mateo Costa, it's a school district, facility manager. And it would be more practical question from your experience. If I have $1 million budget for electric computers, including HVC and electric, and I am planning to spend on 20 schools, let's say $1 million on investment to reduce the Allerton system. What is my saving?
So his question was?
Just electrical, I'm taking electrical and HVC and electrical.
If he has, say, $1 million budget to spend on a control system, yeah. What would his savings end up being?
Right. It's my general fund, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to do a little bit of a cop-out answer here. The first question, the first thing I'd want to know is really to baseline your schools, understand how efficient or inefficient the schools right now. I think a really good source, if there isn't metering present, is something that the CPUC commissioned back in 2006 called the California End-Use Survey. And that says for your average school in PG&E territory, where's the electricity going, where's the gas going? Because obviously that's what we focus. And so you look at, for HVAC and lighting, just those two components of the school, that's 80% of your electricity use. On the heating and hot water side, that's 90% of your gas use. So that's completely where you focus to get, and then there's plug load as well, obviously, that can be come into that. So I'd say the very first step, you've talked about the very first step would be to go into those schools where you're looking to spend that money and figure out where you stack up against the average of PG&E territory. That can give you good insight into how much savings there is. Are you running very efficient? Or is it relatively inefficient? That could kind of give you a rough percentage savings target. So if you'd like to talk, I know that was a very general answer. If you'd like to talk offline, I certainly could go in and we kind of sharpen the pencil a little bit and see what we look like after we do a benchmark. That answer your question somewhat?
Generic.
Yeah, I'm also with San Jose Foster Center. My question for you is, how long does that factor in for school size of 20 schools? How long does that take?
Yeah, so I'd say there's two things. So,
repeat that question.
Okay, yeah, so the question was, for a 20-school school district, how long would it take to do an energy audit? And, I'd say the very first step would be that baseline. I mean, you could get some meaningful information, nothing more than baseline, and then actually going into a full audit, I'd say it depends. I mean, it depends on how many people you throw at it. But I think in, a month, somewhere around that time frame is reasonable.
I had some Scott's comment there about the, you do have a $1 million budget, and you're trying to see what kind of percentage of savings you might do. And that depends on the design of the system that you install. And what you're actually going to control to, and once you have that baseline established, you know where you can start from, then you can go and you can look at different things that you can do in it. And I don't know about some of these other products myself, some of these other companies, but I do know that energy management systems can be scalable, some of them can be. And you may go for the lighting controls first and then add your HVAC controls on in your next phase. Or you may want to just go for the whole entire system at one time. So you can, that percentage will change as to the more things you actually put on and more you would control.
I'm just from experience. It is roughly 50,000-60,000 per school to pick up all components. It will be all HVC plus lighting. It's all together. So it's roughly cost 50,000-60,000 per school. So this
$1 million of what the schools is coming from.
And so, I think the one thing with schools, the biggest challenge with simple paybacks, things like that, is it the limited run hours. I mean, you kind of assume you've got about 180 day of occupied use, unlike a hospital, for example, which would be, is that about?
Not about, because we have a mix of the school with year-round cap and cap itself.
Got it, so you'd be a better candidate.
It's a mixed use.
We've seen energy management systems save anywhere from 10 to 75%, depending on what the system is that you actually put in the design. And so the cost of $50,000 a campus, that's an immaterial number because of whatever you're going to put in. It doesn't really matter. I mean, it matters, but you have to know what you're actually going to install and put in there. And the any vendor would do the ROI analysis for you and show you that on the spreadsheet.
We're about 10 minutes behind, but what we thought we would do is spend 10 more minutes with this panel and then actually go to lunch and then do Mark Johnson's presentation afterward. So that'll give us time to give us a little break to stand up and stretch. So.
Any more questions from the audience? Yes?
So how sophisticated are sensors and inputs these days? I mean, what's the top of the line? I mean, I can imagine that, for instance, my son's schooling is going to be out for 2 weeks, and my guess is, because there's no system there, that building, those buildings are going to be running during those 2 weeks that I'm not here. And so, I mean, are there occupancy sensors, weatherization, weather inputs? I mean, what's the most modern stuff that's going on right now?
Okay, the question again was, how sophisticated are the sensors that are out there today? And the example he gave is a son's school that's going to be closed for a couple weeks, but it has no EMS, no sensors, and it's probably going to be on that whole time. So what's the level of that these days?
Sensors, occupancy sensors, are about 65% efficient in by themselves. There's a new technology coming out that's an imaging sensor. Not really out exactly, but they're doing tests on it, and that would bring it up a little bit more. But occupancy sensors, along with doing an energy management software system and putting scheduling in, makes that system more intelligent, more effective, and that's what part of the energy management system is to give that intelligence to it, set rules up. When is the school going to be open or closed? The building being used, what time, hours of the operation? Those are, so then it makes that sensor even more smarter than by itself.
Yeah, I'd say, if I look at lighting control, I think there's been some incredible breakthroughs in lighting control recently. Where you kind of had the concept, years ago of macro zoning. I'm gonna control off a zone, and maybe 10,000 square feet of lighting's gonna turn off. It's very inefficient. You may have one person coming in, and all of a sudden you're gonna trigger a huge amount of lighting. Now the concept is much more micro zoning, and micro zoning to the point of every single fixture has got its own off sensor, and that off sensor does a whole lot of things. It does, certainly standard occupancy like we talked about. It can be a photocell. It can be a temperature sensor. It can be a submeter. So if you look at it, talked about schools being between lighting and HVAC, call it 80% of your electricity load. Imagine now being able to submeter at every single fixture level, and also dim based on the amount of daylight out there. So I think that's something that's come along tremendously.
I think the sophistication really does come from the EMS system. I mean, you have occupancy sensors, temp sensors, humidity sensors, but then what do you do with that information? And it really goes back to the EMS system.
Can
Can you follow on that with plug load management? Because specifically when you're talking about schools, plug load's a bigger issue, and during holidays and so forth. So how would you address that?
Can you follow up with plug load management under the same lines with schools specifically?
Well, schools are fairly straightforward in that they're highly scheduled, right? And the schedule is, you know, bulk of the schedule is well-known, class schedules, whatnot. EMS allows an user interface is fairly straightforward to use. And again, back to the ability to break down on a per load basis would allow for plug load management. And I think if you look in the scheme of things, plug load would not be where I would focus necessarily. We know it's heating and air conditioning consumption, typically in schools. And if you got that taken care of, plug load would be something that I would attack.
I think there is a problem with plug load. I would have to agree. In my experience, working with schools for 25 years, I see now with microwave toaster ovens, refrigerators per class.
Smart.
Sorry, you're right.
You got to think about what's going on in the classroom. You got smart boards, you got all the electronics.
Absolutely, we know that there's every teacher has a, you know, no teachers in the class. But right, you know, the hidden space is, you're absolutely correct.
And Tim would put, you know, he hit the nail on the head on there that the lighting and HVAC are, you know, your two biggest. Your plug loads would be the third category. You know, take the third seat. But under plug load controls, there's an opportunity there. And then you have all these computer labs in every school. Every school has a computer lab. And think about, think a little bit bigger here, that if you can turn your computers off, you might have software that actually can power them down. But I'm talking about turning them completely off after they've been powered down. Not losing data or anything like that. That's a huge, huge opportunity. We did a computer lab and we saved 65% on our plug load controls right there, just on that computer lab alone. But you have every teacher's desk, every office, there's all kinds of other phantom loads. And if you don't know what a phantom load is, that's the little green and red lights that you see in your house when you're walking around in the middle of the night, that's all the power that's being drawn 24/7. So there is an opportunity there. And you want to keep the perspective that lighting, HVAC are your biggest loads and plug loads are, you know, third down the list.
I have a comment. My understanding is when you try to control the plug loads, this is more from the IT side of the, like, you know, if you want to shut down the computers on energy saving mode, or the copiers, scanners, faxes, so when you buy them with those features, and the IT people who set them up, so they have to set them in energy saving mode. So my understanding is your regular DDC control system is not, those are fragmented thousands of pieces. You cannot connect to them. My understanding is EMS cannot do much about monitoring or controlling those thousand or distributed loads. If there is anything, let us know.
I'm not 100% clear on the question there.
Yeah, okay, so what I want to know is how can an energy management system help facility managers reduce the flood loads that are created by many photocopiers, scanners, faxes, toasters, and
right. Well, you sit down, you figure out what can you power off completely. And I mean, they've done an energy study at PG&E with a class room that TV, just a TV in a room is drawing 24-25 watts, you know, power 24/7. In the standby mode, and the those are, we're talking about inches that we're going for here, but they still add up. And you don't just hibernate the computers. Computers and copy machines are just one item. The other thing is that when you're powering anything down, you are also extending the life of that unit, whatever it is that you are shutting down that's not having to be on and running so much.
Sort of a follow-up question to that. I work for the county as well. Say we've got 5,000 odd employees. Say there's 4,000 employees have a PC. Everyone turns their computers off. There's still 4,000 computers on as you said, phantom plug load. Other than me crawling under my desk and flipping the switch off or pulling the plug out, what controls are there? That applies to the schools too.
We have there's wireless plug power strips and wireless plugs that are available today. That you plug into, and they're intuitive enough that with the energy management system, you set up the rules. And you say, well, we want this computer needs to be on from 8 to 5. But if it senses an occupant in there, then it'll stay on also. If it's a demand response, there's a demand response day, and the folks are going out to lunch, we can kill this for an hour and bring it back up. We can also turn it on at midnight to get your upgrades and your virus program running, and then turn it back on. With the energy management system, you can tell it a lot of different things the way you want it to run and how to control that. It's not just on, off, or occupancy only driven. It can be set up in many different fashions.
Probably the least expensive way I've seen school districts do that is there is a power strip with an aux sensor. Doesn't connect to BMS. You don't really need it to, I don't think. I don't know that that's a wise investment of money to start trying to control all of your individual plugs, but just that there's one that's, as I mentioned, aux sensor, plug load, and those are, I think, they're about $50, and I think PG&E, if I'm not mistaken, it sends all of it back, so it's free.
Yeah, so that's a third-party program, California Energy Efficiency Program. Plug load occupancy sensors are what the technology is commonly referred to. So essentially, if any of you are interested in that, I would recommend connecting with me, and I can basically connect you with the person who handles that whole program. And it's really great for large office complexes, but you want to make sure that it's installed properly. That's a big key. But a lot of times the quality install is the piece that is lacking.
And there is a software that IT can install to shut down computers in office and so forth. There's a software that you can really
just so everyone here, he says there's a software that your IT department can install to shut down computers at certain times. So there's a combination of things, that whether it's a plug load sensor that you can get, it sounds like, for free from PG&E, or installing your own wireless sensor. If the plug load sensor is not enough, it has occupancy stuff as well that controls your BMS, and that would your IT shut it down. Susan's up here, so I think that means we're out of time. Yeah.
If I may see Andy Jane and Tony Ulo first before the masses invade. We are going to be able to get our lunch in the next room, and then there's plenty of water over here to drink, and I think everybody's going to make themselves available that's on the panel over here at these tables to chat with you and around the back of the room. So I just wanted to make that part of the announcement.
I just want to say that you guys are great. Your answers were fantastic, and you guys too. Your questions were super.
Thank you very much, and thanks, Bill, for moderating for us. I mentioned that, so we're switching around the agenda, so we're going to break for lunch now, and we'll be ready to start again at 12:30 with Mark Johnson from PG&E. And where is Mark? Just so that you know, he's available to talk to if you have any questions as well about PG&E issues. And I also wanted to mention, I very briefly mentioned at the beginning that San Mateo County Energy Watch is going to be doing benchmarking for all of the public schools. If you'd like to know more about that, you can ask me or Samir DeBar right here, our AmeriCorps intern, is going to be leading that charge. And so if you would like to get in front of the line, come talk to us. So I think that's it for now. Thank you. We
switched Mark Johnson to now. He is from PG&E and is, I don't know if this is an actual kind of thing, but very knowledgeable with the school. And he's Systems Manager. Great, so thank you, Mark, for talking to us about incentives and programs that can really work well with EMS system.
Great, thank you. Thank you for, first and foremost, for attending today. I really hope that everybody, it's our intent that everybody can walk away with some great information. And more importantly, I just want to stick it in everybody's mind if it hasn't been said already. We have account reps that deal with each individual account for most of your accounts. And or there's a phone number I'll show at the end that you can call into to identify who it is that is your account rep and who can serve you and follow up with any questions. So we don't want to leave you guys, we don't want you to leave today not knowing how to get more access to us. A little bit about myself. I work with school districts. I've been in the energy field since 1987 and have been doing school districts since 2004 exclusively. So that's my forte. And energy management systems has been something we've really focused on in the last couple of years, and it's one of my favorites. So I'm really kind of excited about being able to share what we've learned about it. One of the slides here I want to show is a per capita California kWh, which is electricity, per capita usage versus in like solar proposals and other proposals. Folks will use national numbers for inflation figures and for other things that will affect the calculations. I just say that to be aware of that. Use California numbers. California is so much different than the rest of the country that you really need to use the numbers in our state. Another kind of big picture piece, and I stole this from Tim Sis on a Train, wherever you are, there you are. So they put this together, but I've actually gone to the website. You know, the website looks exactly like this. The California State Loading Order, the published document for how we use energy in the state, basically the state's energy plan, is set up to, the loading order was adopted in 2003 as the Energy Action Plan. And the energy loading order in that plan says, first, attack energy efficiency, then move to demand response, which is rate options that work with time of day usage, and renewable energy, which would be solar and wind, would be your next option, and greenhouse gas reduction, which would be carbon credits, is kind of like the last thing that you would do, and those are in order of making the biggest impact to most customers. So that relates why, and I think Apollo took care of this morning. I'm sorry I wasn't able to be here, but I think he gave you kind of the information of why PG&E is in this energy efficiency. It's part of our business plan. It's part of our model. We're not building power plants anymore, and we're incenting customers to save energy. It works for us, and it also works for our customers. So when we get to PG&E energy efficiency, we have several channels. And I kind of put them all up here just to give you more of a whole view. They don't all relate to EMS systems or to your particular market segment, but we have rebates, we have incentives, we have supporting services, local government partnerships, third-party programs, community programs and pilots, codes and standards, emerging technologies, and there's even quite a bit more that I didn't list. Those are the main ones. Today we'll just focus on the first four that relate to either your market sector or to EMS in general. So what's the difference of rebates and incentives? And you'll hear those terms, and they actually do mean something entirely different. Rebates, for instance, are predetermined after purchase rebates that are figured out on a per unit basis. So we have some catalogs over here. This, for instance, is a lighting catalog. And inside, you'll see that we pay a rebate of whatever, $5, $10, whatever it is, per lamp, per fixture that is replaced. And those are instant style rebates. We also use the term deemed because it's a deemed calculation. It's already prefigured, and it assumes a certain number of operating hours for all customers. I'm sorry, is there a question? Yeah. The other main style of energy efficiency incentive or rebates are the incentives, and incentives are custom calculated incentives that are customized to a particular project. These require pre-approvals, and they require for us to get engaged with that project early so that we can figure out what the savings is going to be. We can see what was there previously, document it, and see what is proposed by the vendor and help push that through for an incentive based on the energy savings. The other type of incentive is our new construction programs, which we have some literature over here on our savings by design. So if you are doing any kind of new construction projects, that is a program that works, and it incents both designers and customers. So your designer as well can get an incentive to go for an extra stretch to make your building energy efficient. Any questions with those? So supporting services that we offer would include things like we have local engineering support in each community to help with energy auditing, defining energy savings that a project might bring in, and kind of work that whole in as it relates to energy incentives and rebates. We have a large integrated audit program, which we have outside vendors that work for us that do integrated energy auditing, which will look at everything from solar generation, demand response, what types of projects will be best fitted for your particular building. So that's something that can also be accessed. We like to keep it kind of focused. We like to do a lot of work with you ahead of time to see where the opportunities are and direct those folks to discover what can be done. Then there's calculation assistance. So again, this is a consultant-driven group of consultants that work for us, and they can provide calculation assistance. We hire them to work on larger scale projects to help really define and work with vendors and customers to find solutions that will pay. Again, it's all in terms of paying rebates and incentives to customers. And this is one that I know that Mike Leslie and I are working on a project right now where we're doing some calculation assistance on that. On-bill financing. I'll have more of these things as we go through, but on-bill financing, I've got some great information on. This is a zero interest loan program for municipal and for schools. It's an up to 10-year zero interest, no points, no fees. And it's designed to pay for itself at a better payment plan, if you will, than the energy savings monthly. So it will be bill neutral or bill positive, not a separate loan that comes to you that you have to pay on top of your project. So we'll get into the details of that. And then we have local government partnerships, which San Mateo Energy Watch is one of them. And Silicon Valley Energy Watch, Ecology Action is also part of this, and many others across our territory that work with governments and communities to implement activities in statewide partnerships, strategic energy resources, data management, climate action planning. There's a whole list of things that they do. And they all don't do this. They all do different things. They don't do the same exact things in every area. So you can check with us on that and see what's available there. So in other programs and services that we offer, technical assistance and incentives for demand response. So does anybody know if they're on any kind of demand response program with us? Okay, great. So demand response programs are those programs that are designed to help shed load. So it's not about moving your load to another time. That's a time of use program. But demand response is when we call you back and when we realize that we don't have enough power to provide everybody. We call an event, and if you're on a rate that incents you to shed load, then you can shed load and bring down the amount of energy being used during that time. You get an incentive for that, for doing so, but we get the power that we can use elsewhere, and that's how that works. That's how we manage our electric grid. So there are also additional incentives, and I want to make this point very clear. When it comes to energy management, EMS systems, there are additional incentives that may be available if your project also means that it's going to participate in a demand response program. So if the controls help the customer get to a place where they can participate in these demand response programs, there are extra incentives and extra monies that we can help provide to that project. So we want to evaluate that when we're talking about EMS projects. So there's energy incentives, energy efficiency incentives, demand response incentives, and financing. All three of those can come together and they all pay their normal thing. The customer can bundle all those together. So we talked about the demand response rate options. Time of use is for shifting load. So if you can shift the load till outside of peak time, that's what a time of use rate will do for you. Not so much about getting rid of and shedding that load. And then other rate options are also available depending on volume, the need of service, lower kW, et cetera. So again, ask the PG&E account rep for assistance with that. They can help craft a solution that's right for you. I want to talk about this, and can somebody, this is kind of a pop quiz, can somebody tell me what this correlates to? We just saw something on this.
A loading
order, thank you. This is the loading order just redesigned and re-put in PG&E's fashion, if you will. But we start with energy efficiency, demand response, self-generation, and carbon offsets, right? And we call that integrated demand side management because we are affecting the demand side of the house, not the supply side, to manage that load. And it's supported, by the way, by emerging technologies and smart grid. Those technologies are helping us get there. So on bill financing, we have done some on bill financing projects, and we're lucky to have Ron Hudson in the house who's done on bill financing with us on an EMS project, and I'll kind of showcase what went on there. And then Ron's also going to be on the customer panel a little later, and he can explain a little bit more about that project. But on bill financing is 100% free, zero interest financing up to 10 years. And I say up to because the variable is the amount of time that we loan the money for, depending on the payback of the project. So if you have, let's say you're doing an energy management project and that project pays for itself in 11 years. We cannot do on-bill financing unless you pay down some money to get it into a 10-year payback. Because we only do a 10-year So, but we would finance 10 years of that project at zero interest, and we would, if that project came down to a 10-year payback, the loan amount every month would be equal to or better than cheaper than the savings that you're coming off of the energy bill. So in theory, the energy bill will stay static. It will not rise. You'll have a loan on there, but what you would have been paying for that inefficient equipment is actually being redirected to the loan. So for 2010-2012, there was a loan pool of 18.5 million. That is rising to, I believe it's 43 or 46 million for next year. So we're putting more money into that and making it more accessible. One of the things I think is going to happen is we're going to require multiple projects. And this is what I was going to talk about as a strategy. And what Ron did on his project is is when you combine lighting with EMS controls to bring the project below 10 years as a cumulative payback, so that that project then could meet the OPF criteria, and it was a bill-neutral experience for the district to move ahead and get lighting and EMS done and have it and pay for it off the savings within, under a 10-year time frame. So it's really a program that is coming out that starts to solve some of these issues for customers when you're dealing with the higher capital investment type of projects, which EMS is typically. So back to, got covered everything on this. For private, those loan amounts are between $5,000 and $100,000. For public entities, schools and local governments, and even federal, it's $5,000 to $250,000 per meter. It is capped at $1 million per customer for munis and muni customers and schools. So you can get up to $1 million. That is a per meter amount that we're showing you. That it's capped at. And the reason we capped that is just to keep a control of it. If we didn't, that money would be gone in an instant because everybody in the brother would be buying for it. So we kind of put some stops in there to make it so that it spreads out to other folks. The loan terms are different. For a private customer, it's 60 months. For public, it's 120 months. We talked about how it's calculated. Again, it's all based on bill neutrality. And the variable is the amount of time that that we will loan the money on the project. The projects that are eligible are energy efficiency projects that we will pay a rebate on. So a caveat piece to that is there are some measures that we pay what we call an upstream rebate to. HVAC equipment is one of them. So we pay manufacturers and distributors to incent them to bring the price down of HVAC equipment. Much of that HVAC equipment would not be eligible for the on-bill financing because the incentive does not go directly to the customer. I'm working to change that, though. So if I get any success, hopefully we can do that. Because I see some big, especially with the advent of Prop 39, I see a lot of money coming down to schools that HVAC will be a big driver that I want to be able to incent. So why are schools and municipal governments great fits for OBF? Of course, bill neutrality is a big thing. Zero interest free money is hard to come by, especially for public institutions. It gets you on the pathway to solar. That's a goal that you have. It does help to that end. Energy efficiency is a step in the right direction. It's going green. Energy efficiency equals reduced greenhouse gases. And the up to 10-year loan term means more capital investment intensive projects. So historically, the market sector has focused on lower cost projects, and now is an opportunity for us to be able to hit these things like EMS and the heavier projects. Another thing I was going to mention with this is the CEC, California Energy Commission, has a 1% loan that's recently come out. It's 1% to municipal governments and schools, and it's up to 15 years, and it's a $3 million maximum. And the same idea applies. It's a bill neutral experience. That's what they shoot for. I don't know that they have a hard stop like we do that it must be, but that's the intent and idea. And you can mix these financing. I mean, if you want, if a customer wanted to, you can use up to $1 million of ours and then go to the CEC and use some of that money too. So these are strategies that I really like to kind of get people thinking about, ways that you might be able to craft your project to really get the most out of it. So what are some benefits outside of the money that participating in energy efficiency programs and PG&E is all about? Engineering analysis and verification through pre and post inspection and verification process. So So when we do a customized project, we have to verify it on a pre-install basis and a post-install basis. So that's another set of eyes, if you will, that help protect you and your project to make sure that it's validated. The build neutrality, of course, is a big thing when you're using the on-bill financing. This allows innovative web-based controls, will allow greater participation in demand response, saving, and I have district in there, but it's municipal governments as well, even more money. So when we come up with the rebates for these, we're just looking at energy efficiency off of the energy bill, not the fact that you could participate in demand response programs or that whole other piece, right? That's not even figured into it. So those are added features and added savings that we don't even use in our calculations that a customer can get further than just the incentives. Project costs are offset by rebates. So essentially you're bringing down your project cost, applying your rebate to it. So it helps bring your project cost down. And enhanced learning environment in the school sector anyway for students, staff, more comfortable people, even if it's an office building, are going to be that's a much better situation, more productivity you're going to get than if everybody's uncomfortable. We also don't include maintenance costs, maintenance savings, savings from avoided capital costs and other things that would enter into an ROI equation. We don't consider that when we're calculating energy savings. We strictly go by simple payback. And I point that out because there are a lot of other savings that are going to occur by doing an energy efficiency project that we're not allowed to encapsulate in our programs. So one of the biggest things is maintenance costs and reduced staff time working on, maybe it's lighting you're changing out. The new technology, the lamps last so much longer than the old ones. You're not sending people up and down ladders, not to mention safety and everything else. Those are all savings we'll come back to. Okay, so now one of my favorites is a case study of Kings Canyon. Kings Canyon is a K-12 public school system. They serve students in a 600 square mile area. They're one of the largest geographic districts in California, and they're located in Fresno County. So Ron Hudson came up from Reedley today just for this meeting, and I really appreciate it, Ron, and allowing us to feature your project here. Train was the company that actually provided the vendor services, project management, implementation, installation, the products, and the staff training. So this is one of their projects as well that we worked with them on. And we don't, we are vendor agnostic, so any of the vendors here are fantastic vendors. I'm only using trains because they happen to work on this project, but all of you, the vendors that we have are just, do absolutely great work, so I want to thank all of you for that. So the project scope in this case was to upgrade 6 schools with a new EMS system with a web-based platform so that they can control it through a web-based or a laptop in the field. So we upgraded the lighting to high-performance T8s with high-color temperature, low-wattage 25-watt lamps. So these are 25-watt T8s that have a higher color temperature closer to daylight. In a school's environment, it really brightens the room up. It makes it the contrast on paper much better. Students learn better from it. It matches daylighting that streams through the windows. So we combined the EMS and the lighting together to make a much better payback on this project. We also did some outdoor and gym lighting with LED. And we utilized the on-bill financing. It was bill neutral with under a 10-year project payback. So when we look down at what did this cost, since there was a question on what can I do with $1 million, I think was kind of a question earlier. Well, this was under $1 million, and we were able to do 6 of these schools with the project costs, the incentives, the loan amounts are there. monthly payments. And you can see on the bottom, the project savings was over 560,000 kWh and 74 kWh annually. Monthly savings attributed or were calculated to be more than the loan payment. So it came out very bill neutral for them.
Sure. I have a question, and I apologize if I missed it. What was the square footage total for the six campuses?
We're talking about energy intensity. I didn't.
Also looking at investment for square foot.
Yeah, I didn't. I didn't run those numbers. Tim didn't either. I don't have these at hand, but we probably could figure something out and get something back to you. So it wouldn't be too difficult to figure that out. In fact, Tim's not in his head; he's willing to take that off my shoulders. So thank you, Tim. And an excellent question. I want to mention we were had this discussion earlier about energy intensity per square foot. Really important information to know is what is your energy intensity per square foot, right? Because that's kind of we use it a lot in new construction. I see it all the time in new construction programs, but I don't see it applied much on the retrofit. And it's a lot of variables there, and you can't maybe quantify it as easy as new construction, but it's nonetheless as relevant in a retrofit market. So great question. Is there any other questions? I've got a slew of information on the tables over here about different demand response rates. I really want you to take away from this the idea of bundling. You know, we used to do a lot of lighting projects and low-hanging fruit, if you will. And my fear is if we keep doing that and not doing energy management and the more capital-intensive projects, we won't have another smaller payback project to bundle with that, to bring that payback down in a project sense that will fit within a financial instrument that we can apply to it. So I think the big takeaway is that, you know, look at these projects from a more holistic approach because the landscape has changed in the last couple of years. We have time variable pricing, which is coming down. I think Nepal talked a little bit about that this morning, but time variable pricing, you know, is customers paying real-time prices. And when prices go up during the middle of the day, a customer's ability to be able to control their own energy is going to be key to that effort. So, if you can't control it, and if you can't, easily turn things on and manage it, you're really going to be feeling like you're held hostage to market rates. And we don't want to see that happen. We want you to have your fingers on the switch. So so that's that. So thank you. I'll be here if there's any follow-up. Feel free to ask me.
Thank you, Mark. That actually serves up really well our last panel. And I'm going to introduce our moderator, Bob Cormier from Foothill College. Bob is on the so I mentioned that we're
part of sustainability, where we've been, where we are now, and where we're going. And the history of our EMS is very interesting, as you'll hear in a moment. We've just installed the latest version of an EMS, but our first one, we actually started in 1985. So we've been at it a while with the manual controls. We've added a large-scale photovoltaics at both Foothill College and De Anza, but especially at Foothill. We're constantly renovating. We were very lucky. We got a bond measure 6 years ago before bond measures dried up. As you know, both county, CSM, San Mateo Community College District and Foothill De Anza College District both missed out at our last parcel taxes. So we've been able to do a lot on the one that we finished 6 years ago. And really, the term of retro commissioning and monitoring-based commissioning, that's important in our strategy and our long-term vision. So the history of our EMS, we started in 1985 with a no-bar system that allowed us manually, remotely, to turn on and off air conditioning. And we thought that that was just amazing, to be able to turn a switch. Of course, we added computers to that in 1993 and 1994, and then it became way too complicated for us to deal with. We did not have a system that could aggregate that information. We looked to Chevron Energy Solutions, and they came in and helped us out during a period where I'll show you a graph. It's the one that Susan talked about, where we saw enormous energy changes. We've been working on a Niagara VAX system, but we also have in place a little bit of Siemens, some Schneider. It can integrate trends, and we're working towards potentially Tritium. We have a JSPOX, which is part of our open control system, so we have all the mechanicals and all the electronics that will bubble up to an application platform, part of Niagara, and then we'll have a dashboard that will allow us to actually see what's going on, and very importantly, see what's going on, what's working, what's not, and what isn't doing what it's supposed to. The three key things that we do want to monitor are electricity, hydronics. We heat and chill most of our buildings through a central plant, and so understanding the hot water inputs, how they come back, cold water inputs, how they come back, for a total of 72 buildings, which is one of our pain points. We have 72 buildings, and none of them are separately monitored yet. And the mechanicals part of our HVAC. Does anyone want to take a guess as to how many points of connection we have in our mechanicals now and what our goal is? Throw out a number. You're in the right ballpark. We have 100,000 and we're going towards a 250,000. Yeah. But I think when all is said and done, when you look at 75 buildings, that will be at 2 million. So that's a key thing to remember when you're thinking about all of this automation. So very quickly to summarize, our board, Foothill De Anza, 2 decades ago made a very strong strategic commitment to energy efficiency. We planned our bonds not only to renovate buildings, but to add energy management systems. John Schultz, who was the executive director prior to Charles Allen, made a commitment sort of on the back of the envelope that he wanted to cover all of our new building space, approximately 200,000 square feet at Foothill, with photovoltaics, so that when we added new buildings, the energy impact of those buildings simply wouldn't be there. And we've actually accomplished that in the last year. And it's really the planning ahead and the commitment by the board. We are signatory to ACU-PCC. It's the longest acronym that you'll see this morning and afternoon. It stands for the American College University's President's Climate Commitment. And it's all about climate action plans, becoming carbon neutral, and energy efficiency is a big piece of our CAP. So this is one of two charts, and this is a startling chart. This is our energy use, electricity, on both campuses, so both Foothill and De Anza, it's our district total, sitting here at about 1.4 million kilowatt hours per month, and we're moving up through 1993, 1994, and look at that amazing rise in energy. Brought in all this new air conditioning and whatnot, and then as we're renovating buildings, we brought in energy management control so that we could actually match our schedule and our occupancy to what the building controls were doing. It dropped as precipitously as it went up. The area under this curve dropping from about 1.7 million to 1.4 million, this is about a 20% drop in energy, peak demand. Total. So it's an enormous amount of energy. But can you tell me what the area under this curve probably represents? Energy we didn't have to use. And you think that we're unique in the world in that area. We're not. By the way, this line going up right here, this is we're adding new buildings and we don't have all the controls on them yet. So this is this little roller coaster ride. If you were to look at a history, and our district is very good in keeping all of our energy bills. We can go back 20 years and we can tell a story. We can understand where we've been, what our targets should be. This is our natural gas use, a little bit harder to understand because how many of you monitor your natural gas use other than the main utility meter for your campus or organization? So I'm not seeing many hands. We have 2 gas meters on campus, and that doesn't really tell us much about where we're pushing this energy. And we use it for cogen, we use it for heating, and understanding the difference between those two is very important in terms of analytics. So I want to briefly discuss what we did with our photovoltaics and our cogen. This is a lot of stuff and bother. I'm speaking mostly to Foothill College. We invested our bond money, which is almost $500 million, very carefully prior to the market
taking its downturn in 2009. Because we did that, we had money in tranches that were very effective to us. So we were able to borrow forward against future interest, and we put up we put up 1 megawatt of new solar photovoltaics in the last 2 years. It's a ginormous amount of energy. It covers a huge parking lot about the size of 3 football fields. And the amount of energy, as you'll see in a moment, coming from 1 megawatt of photovoltaics literally swamps the campus. There are times during the day when we're producing more energy than we need, but we've actually modeled that energy so as we bring on our last set of buildings, we'll be able to absorb it. This amount of energy produces over 2 million kilowatt hours of electricity at Foothill. That's 25% of the energy that we use. So we use about 8 million kilowatt hours at Foothill. We produce about 1.75 million with our Capstone microturbines. How many of you understand cogen or have heard of cogen? Okay, that's a good number. If you haven't, we simply take natural gas that we would use, that we would burn and heat our swimming pool. We heat it, well, we burn it, and we spin a turbine, we make electricity, we capture 30% of that energy. The 70% that would normally go up the stack, we recirculate with another fluid that extracts 70% of that energy, or 50% of the internal energy, takes that energy, goes to heat the swimming pool. So we're getting free electricity while we're heating our swimming pool, or we're making our own electricity, not most too efficiently, and then heating the swimming pool for free. The key is when you have a huge thermal load for energy efficiency and for also managing the electricity that we need throughout the year, we can throttle these up and down. These two combined, we can produce 80% of our peak power in the afternoon. You've heard the term TOU, time of use. If we had to actually buy at market rates, time of use, in the afternoon, our bills could go to the point where we simply may not have the cash there to be able to pay them. And that's exactly the description that Mark mentioned. You don't want to back yourself into that corner of not being able to pay a bill. So half of our energy is emission-free. We reduce our greenhouse gases by 2 million pounds, the quick math on that, 1,000 tons of CO2 from our photovoltaics. It's an enormous amount of CO2 saved. The energy savings, I was hoping someone will ask, so how much money did you put into this, and how much energy have you saved? If we did nothing in terms of energy efficiency with Chevron Energy in the mid-1990s, and we saw that curve, we'd probably be sitting about 20% higher, so somewhere around 10 million kilowatt hours for Foothill College alone. If you look at our price of electricity, we're paying 12 cents, which is a darn good rate. That's $250,000 annually saved. Now, most of that is from energy efficiency, but some of that is from energy management systems. So we put in $1 million and we're saving about $250,000 a year. So the simple payback on that would be about 4 years. We did that 10 years ago. We have to do that again. We have to add another $1 million. When you invest in energy efficiency as an organization, you're probably bundling it with energy management systems. I actually said that backwards. When you bring in your EMS, you're probably bundling it with energy efficiency, so you really can't untangle those. But our target goal from where we are right now is to reduce our energy by another 20%, about 10% from energy efficiency and 10% from energy management systems. So this is a very interesting chart. If someone tells you that interval metering is not interesting or that it's boring, you have to tell them that they've never seen a chart like this. So I call this the building, this is the pulse of our entire campus. And this takes us from in the morning, people come in, they turn things on, we have PK HVAC coming on in the afternoon, they go home, middle of the night, we get our resting phase. We come in Tuesday, we do the same thing, energy goes down. Wednesday, we come up, same thing, kind of warm that day, Thursday, Friday. Saturday and Sunday, we have these mysterious data points. We have no idea what's going on. Gosh, I wish our EMS could tell us. Because wouldn't it be great to park your base load down at about that level? That's thinking. So this is when we add our photovoltaics, right about here in April of 2011. This was our power failure test to make sure that when we turned our power off, there was no EMF going onto the network. So when the power, when the PVs came on, boom, this is when your power meter is importing no energy from PG&E. We're actually pushing energy back right there and right there and every single day. But the more interesting thing is look what happens right about here to our peak load. It goes down with a photovoltaic. So not only are we pushing energy back at about 11 o'clock in the morning, our total energy at 3 o'clock in the afternoon is better. And the quick question or question is, how do you create an energy management system that leverages that energy production? And that's what we're actually working on. So you may not know this, it's a regulation in California. Tenured faculty members, when speaking in public, have to show at least one figure of merit and one equation, otherwise their tenure is revoked. So building energy intensity, BUI, we measure it in BTU per square foot. If you're into SI units and even geekier, it's about a kilojoule per square foot, if you see that in the paper. We're sitting at 100,000 BTU per square foot at Foothills campus. I cannot tell you when, where, and how we're using energy, but that is the aggregate over 75 buildings. You think 100,000 is a good number? Outside of California, it's a good number. Inside of California, I think we can do better. So when you look at energy-efficient buildings, you can hit 60, 70,000 BTU per square foot. That gives us about 25,000 BTU to 30,000 BTU, or about 25 to 30% energy savings. We think we can get there. I do need to leave you with an equation. It's called energy intelligence. It's a twist on Einstein. Energy intelligence uses computers to monitor, model, and manage energy. So we can monitor energy, and you get a chart. You can model it, when, where, and how is energy being used, and then manage it better, what can you do about it? The feedback loop is plan, do, check, act. If you've been through environmental science or sustainability, this is your standard feedback. We want to make sure we're using our PV and our cogen to the best of our ability, but the key is use an EMS to understand building energy. We have 20 to 30 different building types. We have never benchmarked any of them, and none of them have been commissioned. So what do you think that leads us to do next? We have to monitor all of our buildings, and we have to benchmark them against similar buildings. That's a massive retro-commissioning effort. We're going to connect our panels, look at electricity, look at the hydronics, and look at the mechanicals. Just for the maintenance aspect alone, we can save a bundle. We're going to collect that data, and then look at energy intelligence, get it into our feedback loop, for constant improvement, because that's what these systems do. So I think in the interest of time, we will go to the panel. Okay, great, and then we'll start taking questions. So Andy, Ron, and Lynn will come up here and take questions.
Was is financially healthy. We have the largest reserve of any school district in three counties. We were able to look, we turned over every stone, we looked at everything that we could be efficient on. And as a result, not only the reserve, but we didn't have to do any layoffs. There was only two school districts in three counties that didn't have to do layoffs or reduction of school days and all that sort of thing. And we were one of them. One of the things that jumped out at me early on was energy. And I kind of got wrapped up in it because we were $1.5 million paying this bill to Mark Johnson. I got tired of, you know, he doesn't drive around in a car that looks like I pay him $1.5 million a year. But I got to know Cheryl Marcelli McFlane, who was our representative. And you saw that little tagline at the bottom of Mark's thing. It said, call for assistance. And I called Cheryl, and I got to know her. And one of the things that she keeps telling me and Mark keeps telling me is that very few districts that they go into that they have the ability to have access to the CBO or the superintendent. Well, that was a big bill, $1.5 million. And so I got intrigued and interested in trying to save energy. And Cheryl Marcelli McLean became my new best friend. And then soon thereafter, Mark Johnson became my new best friend. And we've been doing things with them for a number of years, from rebates to audits to some this program, all the way to the program now that the on-bill financing
that we just implemented in Kings Canyon Unified at 6 sites. And my next best friend was Tim Sisson with Train. We had been with Train for a number of years, got to know Tim and some of his engineers. I'll tell you two things I like about Mark, and I haven't told this about to Mark or Tim, but these two guys are techies to a certain extent, but they understand education. They understand the what I have to do to sell the board or the community or teachers. So when we're buried in the data with these guys, I call them back and say, "No, can you interpret that for me so I can explain it to my board or to the teachers?" Or vice versa. They help me a lot, and I think I help them too, to bridge the gap between data and energy efficiencies and all the numbers that Bob threw up there, which I'm impressed with. I had a nice talk with Bob on Sunday. But then how to communicate that and have buy-in from the community. We come from a very, very conservative farming community. And for them to jump on board with something that's green, I got a lot of pushback. Now, I had 28 years in the district, so I had a good reputation. I could get away with a lot of things and do some things and ask for forgiveness later. And the board was reluctant in the beginning to even look at energy efficiency. It just looked too green and too way out there. To the point where just a year ago, when I pulled the plug after a year-long look at solar, they said, "Why did you do that?" And I had to explain it to them why we pulled the plug on solar at this time. One of the things that I finally understood from Mark and from Cheryl is that loading order. Here was people that I thought needed to sell more energy to make a living. But that's not the business that PG&E is in. Here they were telling me how to save energy in all these various ways, and they were sending me people, and we bought into their program. But that loading order finally made sense. Get your act in order first with energy management. Then move towards solar. Not that I'm opposed to solar. And I think that we're going to be there. I don't know what shape it's going to be or whatever. We're going to be there. And we're pushing hard at the school I am now to move towards that. But first and foremost, get your ship in order with efficiencies. And I like what they're doing now. It's not these little silos of efficiency. It's more of a, what Cheryl says, is an integrated approach. And that's what Train brought to us, and that's what PG&E brought to us. And they form a good team. We spent, what, a year? Almost a year just in planning in the war room. Data after data after data. I don't know how they hung in there, but I liked it. Because I knew at the end we were going to have something that would be sustainable for a long period of time. And I look around at some of my buddies and the superintendents in the area, and they jumped on board to some things way too quick, and I'm getting feedback now that they made a mistake. I think this, if you're really going to do this energy thing right, you have to look at the data for a long period of time and then pull together a team. And now Bob, I can tell, he's been living with this for a long time, a lot longer than I have. So I'd like to pick his brain someday. I think he's got an integrated approach that, and all the numbers to justify what he does. So I'll stop there. Is that enough for now?
Perfect.
Okay.
I'm Andy Jane. I'm the energy manager with the County of San Mateo. So I've been working with county for around 2.5 years. Prior to this, I used to be a consulting engineer and also used to help one of the companies sell mechanical equipment like boilers and pumps, etc. So the county of San Mateo got from EECPD funds around $3 million, and they needed an energy manager to plan and spend the funds. And the board of supervisors and the county manager said that before we spend all this money on one or two big projects, for instance, we wanted to spend all the money on a big cogen at the San Mateo Medical Center. So county manager said that, you know, we had to first have a plan. So we selected a firm, Innovity, to do an audit, investment grade audit of 10 of our facilities. So the audit took like a year and a half, and all the energy master plan. So now we have an energy master plan, which has around $17 million worth of projects that range from energy management, system upgrades, to equipment upgrades, to lighting, to cogen, and some of the solar PV projects. So we got various projects, and now we have prioritized them, budgeted them, and now again we are going to our board of supervisors to get some revolving funds so that we can plan and execute those projects. So I am with the DPW Public Works with County San Mateo. So I'm responsible for energy management, and I think my role is to reduce the gas, electric, water bills for the county. But I'm also very much involved in various project management of selecting contractors, consulting engineers, and deciding which projects to do, how to do. So I've been providing my services to the county. And specifically what I want to talk to you here about relevant to today is the energy management and control systems. So I have been involved with two or three projects, and I will give some overview of those projects. And before that, so San Mateo County has around 45 facilities, around 15 or 20 are major facilities, more than 50,000 square feet. And our annual gas electric bills are around $6 million. So one of the biggest concern is to reduce the operating costs, reduce the gas, electric, water bills. And now, of course, we do not have as many stationary engineers, operating engineers, as we had before. So we have to manage, provide comfort, reduce the bills, and provide all the comfort conditions with less number of people. So this project that I'm going to talk about is the Hall of Justice Energy Management Control System Upgrade. So I was a project manager for this project. And to give you a timeline, so even before I started, people already knew. So this is our 1955 vintage building, part of it done in 1955, part of it done in 1968. And it had gone through various iterations of building management control system. Data was Robert Shaw, DMS controls, pneumatic controls. So there was a time to upgrade the controls. And it was not merely to, there was not like one factor to which we should do it, but there were various factors. So it was already decided that we got to do this project. And this building has many other issues too. So before doing the project, the economizer outside air dampers were replaced. And then a boiler project was going on, the boilers were replaced, and then at that time we decided we got to do the controls upgrade as well. So first the issue was, how do we do a project? Do you go to an energy services company? Do you design it yourself? And then you go out to bid? So this was the first time for me to do all this thing and understand. So it took me quite a while to see how the industry works and what different options are. So we selected Taylor Engineering to design the project for us, and due to my prior experience and good recommendations. So it's very important before you design a system to know what is involved in the project. And a lot of good MEP firms or consulting engineers, but they are not necessarily good with controls, who do not understand the controls design as good or would not be as detailed. So we selected them. And they took around 3-4 months, and there's so many variation of drawings, there's so many things done, the drawings don't exist, so there's a lot of field verification, meeting with our stationary engineers, and so much information resides in one person's head, he knows how things work. So understanding and gathering all the information took quite a while, and through many iterations, the drawings were, specs were finalized. And then we went with the many kind of unit pricing. So we anticipated that when they will be doing the job, as in while doing the job, we'll find out things that will be broken. So we will discover them, we'll fix them. So there was like a per line item or per equipment pricing was helpful, per point pricing was helpful. And then the issue was, who do we work with? So we are a public entity, and we cannot say we like only Johnson or Siemens or whoever. So what we do is we go through the job order contracting method. If there is a certain leeway that we have as to who do we work with. And so we invite all the controls contractors to bid on the job. Half of them, or most of them, did not show up. Some showed up and they found the job to be very complicated, and they did not give their bids. And finally, we had train and automated controls who bid the job. However, it is more that the company automated controls, they have been, they are the ones who install the systems, and they have serviced the system, and they know our people. That was a big consideration why we chose automated controls, not that, you know, their controls or their equipment or sensors and devices weren't that great, but our people feel more comfortable than the people who provide services. So that was a consideration, and yes, they have BB controllers who are like fully programmable and some other, and the consulting engineer had worked with them before. So the contractor and the consulting engineer had a better relationship, and based on dealer engineer advice, we selected automatic controls. So the project was started for nearly $1 million, and but I knew, you know, we would need some more funds. So the project was started in January 2011, and project took way longer than we expected. We had to extend the project many, many times. So there were many, many technical issues that came in there. So all the work was supposed to be done in the night, so you have to finish the zone in the night, and by morning you have to get ready for people to work in the daytime. And there's some areas with asbestos and access issues and being a cold, and special sheriff's areas, access and coordination. So many, many issues were involved in the project. So one by one, so doing all the controls, wiring, and setting up the infrastructure, and the floor by floor. So finally, the project has been completed, is almost completed. So the commissioning is going on. So now with the system that we have, so from an IP, wherever you are internet, you can access what's going on in each floor, with each BAV box, with each air handler. So we have, the first and foremost thing you gotta do is the stop the thing that is not required. There's a lowest common denominator thing, which probably has the biggest saving before optimizing, fine-tuning, and doing what not. So now we have connected all the split units, heat pumps, and many specialized units. So everything we know, what is running, what is not running. And we are monitoring our gas, electric, through the energy management system. We implemented some of the fancy controls like supplier temperature reset, duct static pressure reset, and there are a whole lot of research, chilled water resets, many, many temperature resets that we are doing. And at times, I believe, I kind of like those things, and so those things were implemented, but our operating staff, the people who actually are running the building, there's a gap between their understanding, their knowledge level, or their comfort level versus the complexity of controls that we have brought in. So it's very, very important to include your operating people. As a project manager, you would move on to some new project, but the people who have to live with that system, they should feel comfortable with that. So bringing them on board in many, many levels of training, and especially with the commissioning, we are learning. There was a big gap between how they wanted things to work, and if they do not feel comfortable, they will disable them, do not use them, and things can go back. So the result is that that over the year, but it is very, very difficult to know exactly what measure gave you how much energy savings, unless you do very, very detailed measurement verification. So what you have in a building is there's just one electric meter. And if your electric consumption goes down, it can be attributed to many, many things. So we have done the economizer upgrade, boiler upgrade, controls upgrade. So I cannot say if this is exclusively due to EMCS upgrade. However, we have saved like around $100, $1,000 in 11 months. It's around 12% of energy reduction. Overall, around 7 or 8% due to electric, and whooping 30-35% due to gas. But the big benefit of doing this energy management control system is before we had the system, I mean, we had a system, reasonable, kind of okay system, DDC system, not only DDC, pneumatic system, but it was still shooting in the dark. So not only it helps you save energy, but the people who are actually resolving the issues, it really helps them troubleshoot. Before someone goes there in that room where you have a complaint, you can look up things from your system. So right from how what chill water is going, what air temperature is there, so it really helps them. So that is one project. Other project that I worked on is crime lab controls upgrade. And what happens is we try to improve the energy efficiency here, and it's Yamas Control did the job like only 8-9 years ago. And everyone, consulting engineer, contractor, everyone imagined that the VAV boxes will give a damper position and you will be able to implement this strategy. And when you actually do the job, you find out, no, it's not there. So it's very, very important to do a field verification, testing, very, very detailed, not just talk to someone, one quick visit and things are done. And then another issue is, if you work with the same vendor, so we got a proposal from automatic control or Yamas, whose system was there for $50,000, everyone else was $200,000. Because others had not just to implement the new sequence of operation, but they were forced to change the controllers as well. So at times you are tied in the proprietary systems or lower level, field level control systems. So you have to work with different vendors, and your operating people have to learn different systems. So it's very important to understand in detail what the system is, and then plan those upgrades. So the other thing that I have learned or is important is, with the number of operating people we have, their mindset is firefighting. You got a complaint, you solve it, and that's it. And all it is spent in getting complaints and solving them. And to ask them to look about energy efficiency or energy savings, I mean, they don't get more salary for saving energy. So the incentives are not aligned, at least to the line staff, operating engineer people, and they are the ones who know these things as to. So changing focus and using these tools and increasing the ability. So every entity has to have at least one or two people who are especially trained in understanding building trends, using energy management systems. So understanding and training is very important, and the focus needs to be changed from maintenance to saving energy. So that's been my experience.
Good afternoon, everybody. Try to keep it short, I promise. My name is Lynn Ortega. I'm with the County of Santa Clara. I am the Utilities Engineer and Program Manager. I have responsibility for the county's utilities budget, as well as finding ways to save energy and reduce our greenhouse gases. Let me give you a little bit of background on the county. So the county actually has approximately 250 facilities scattered throughout the entire county. Roughly 10 million square feet of space. So, finding ways to bring all these buildings together is a bit of a challenge, but I'll get into that in a moment. Just a little bit more background. Energy that we use, electricity that we use on these facilities is about 120 million kilowatt hours a year. That's a lot of energy, a lot of money too that we pay mostly to PG&E. That's approximately $14-15 million a year. So, we have definitely the motivation, I should say, to find ways to reduce our costs, reduce our usage of electricity. And so, probably since the early 90s, the county has been very proactive in implementing energy efficiency. I think around the mid 90s, we did a very, very large project to retrofit all of our T12s into T8 lighting. So, early on, like I said, we took some proactive measures to to mitigate our cost and our electricity usage. Since then, we've been doing retrofits on our facilities, everything from HVAC to lighting controls and pretty much everything that's we consider to be low-hanging fruits. We've continued to do that. In our newer facilities that we've constructed, we've put in place all of these energy efficient features, and we've also included, I don't want to say energy management systems, but rather building control systems. I'll get into that in a moment as well. So we've been able to keep our costs at a controllable level in our energy use is the same by doing those things. Now, today, I guess since the topic is energy management systems, I said we have over 250 buildings. These range in vintage. These are from the early 1900s to fairly new buildings that we just recently constructed. Many of these facilities, especially the larger ones, let's say over 50,000 square feet, have building control systems of some sort. Some of them still with pneumatic, many of them with DDC systems. Now, I draw the distinction between building control systems and energy management systems because, in my view, energy management systems really should do just that, is to allow you to manage your facilities or manage the energy usage in the facilities, not only on a by-building basis, but over across your portfolio of facilities. Building control systems, on the other hand, you know, do just that. Show you what the status, the conditions of your facility is, how it's operating, whether it's operating. But, you know, in my experience, and I'm not an expert, so I'll just disclose that up front. In my experience with building control systems, they don't quite do everything that they need to do for us from an energy management standpoint. I know this because for the last 10 years, I've actually been actively searching for an EMS system. Done two failed solicitations. I think in the first one, really, I received a lot more questions from the interested vendors that wanted to provide proposals. I didn't know the answers to questions. I mean, that was the reason why I issued the solicitation. This was for an energy management system. And we did a follow-up as well, and that was unsuccessful. So I guess that's one thing I can share with you. When you do prepare these solicitations, you need to put a lot more thought, certainly more than what we did back then. There is a lot more to an energy management system than just, you know, sensors and actuators. You know, there's programming, there's strategies, there's thought that needs to go into it. You know, we have probably every building control system you can think of, and I don't know all the names. Again, I'm not an expert in this particular area of automation, but we have a number of them, and even systems of the same brand oftentimes don't talk to each other just because they're from a different version, let alone systems of different brands, different manufacturers. That was one of our main challenges when we issued out our first solicitation for an EMS system, is that that communication wasn't there. Again, this is 10 years ago, and what I hear here today is that that has vastly improved. The communications protocols available that are now embedded in these new technologies make it much easier. And so one of our next steps in the county is to look at that again, find ways to control our energy usage. I hear PG&E coming up with real-time rates, and so we do need to be prepared for that. We have a lot of buildings, we use a lot of energy. Certainly, we have the right motivation to that. One of the things I did mention in terms of background, that 10 years ago, we actually thought about these things. We implemented a large sub-meter project where we installed over $1 million worth of sub-meters in our larger facilities. That was in preparation for, you know, bringing on board an EMS system. And I'm not just talking about a building control system, but rather an overarching, an umbrella system, if you will, that would actually allow us to manage our energy usage real time so that we could take either manual or automatic action to mitigate, in particular, our peak demand charges, because in many of our buildings, as is the case with probably a lot of yours, 30% of our electric bill is really in the peak demand, and that's really the driving factor for us to try and find a way to control our energy usage when we control it, and that is through the EMS system. Those are the things that I wanted to share with you today, and I guess after this we'll be opening up for questions.
Contractor to prepare a bridging document, for example, so that you can kind of get your hands around the whole thing. That's a lot of square feet and a lot of systems.
It is. So to answer your question is yes, we did work with Chevron back in 2004. It's been a while. Technology has advanced. Now, having said that, since then, we attempted two solicitations, one with Chevron, and then we did a subsequent, right after that. After that, we've been continue to focus on energy efficiency, is what we've been doing, also on renewable energy. So we just, recently installed close to 6 megawatts of solar in various facilities. We've just recently negotiated some diesel contracts as well. So we are we've been busy, but now, part of the reason why I'm here is because I wanted to hear what others are doing so that we can get to that point. But yes, we, once we move forward, we will certainly be doing that.
Perhaps as a summary, I'm fairly new to this area. My background comes from internet technology, but I've always loved construction and buildings. And I'm also, my background biology, biochemistry, is that buildings are designed somewhat as systems. The older you go back, the less it may be true that you have an envelope and then you bring in your mechanicals. And I think today what we're seeing is that when you put a building out to spec and say it goes into value engineering, that you don't always end up buying a building that's going to be the best building for the long haul. And as a college district, we're investing 50 years into the future, 100 years into the future, but even for us, to invest in an energy management system to protect us 10 years in the future, should there be an energy shock and not having the cash there, the moral of what we've learned for our story is that really to put as much money as you can into building the very best building possible, make it efficient, try to have local generation of power somewhere on campus or nearby, and by all means, make it able to manage itself. Every biological system has that ability to know where to put energy at the right time for the right activity, how to adjust on demand dynamically, and yet our buildings really aren't able to do that. And when you go back and you're looking at 50-year-old systems, you have to almost dissect and go all the way back to square one, or the County Hall of Justice, dealing with 60-year-old buildings. And that's what makes this effort so challenging, and it's no wonder that when we go out for a solicitation, that we don't always guess what we thought we needed.
So I just had more of a statement, or maybe to flush some of the questions might come out of this. The way I've seen a lot of different projects, different sizes. The one takeaway I would say is number one, there is no best solution that everybody can point to and say that's best, right? It really is about matching a system to your needs. And many vendors can provide many different solutions. All of them can be great. It's just really what's the best fit for you. But also on the, I see it as a scheme or a whole arrangement of choices on how you administer this. There's something as simple as if you've got a very small, simple system that you want to put in. I know for schools, you don't have to go through a bid process. That's not to say that that's right for you or not right for you in your situation, but there are exceptions, especially in the energy field with code that is written so that schools do not have to use a bid process if they know exactly what they want. And maybe it's small enough that it's not going to justify hiring somebody else to go out and do it. So I plant that seed, just that's one option that can be evaluated.
The other end of the spectrum is that maybe you're doing such a big project that you do need a consultant to come in and help bridge that gap of knowledge. Saying I want an energy control system in an RFP is, you know, kind of like saying I want a house, right? There's a lot of questions that will come back as to, well, what kind of house do you want, and how big do you want it, and how, you know, is it important to have a big kitchen, or is it? I mean, there's just a myriad of you know, best fits that need to be fleshed out. And so I see oftentimes projects that go out to bid that are very open like that, and then 1,000 different suggestions come back in, and they're, you know, the school district is just overwhelmed with choices, and don't really have the expertise to be able to select what's right for them. So I just throw that out as more of a discussion point, that there's just many different, and you really need to look at what is it I'm trying to do, and what the scale of it is, and what the right fit is, and who to get on board to do that. On the simplest thing, you can call many of the vendors that we have here today to get free advice as to what would you do with this system, and interview a few of them and get some information to start honing in on what it is you want to control. So just more of an observation.
With my professor hat, BTU per square foot. Everyone in this room knows the mileage that their car gets, right? I'm sure you do. But I bet less than half the people in this room really know their energy footprint where they live. And it's important to know that. Log into your smart meter, go to myenergy.com, and look at when, where, and how energy is being used, and you'll discover something that you can fix immediately.
I think
we have
one more
question. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so I'm curious about what kind of analytics and types of things that can be done with an energy management system once it's in place. And I guess in some ways I'm thinking, okay, so you know, you have a building that has an antiquated system and you put that on, and then you go with a modern energy management system and it has all the pieces that you need, but still there's, you know, what's the next weak link, I guess, in some ways, you know? You know, is it the education of staff on how to use it, or, you know, that it's being monitored appropriately, you know, updated with the time and day, you know, information, that kind of thing. So once you have a system in place, what's next?
Okay, good question. One, you know, when we call energy management control system, it is still largely, I would say, it's a building control system. So some of the energy monitoring analytics are being included, but still you need something above and beyond an energy management system, especially if you are talking about a multi-campus, like a county or a city or a big school board district. You need a system, let's say energy cap or a utility manager or some other kind of program which takes into factor, like, you know, various facilities you have, how many kWh, how many gallons of water, how many tons of gas, and then you know, various reports can be run. So energy management system is more for the operating people. However, you can monitor real-time energy consumption, and you can see, if I do this thing, what happens to my energy, rather than waiting for a month or using someone else's services to know. So if you're monitoring the real-time energy use, so you can test your, and you can see, and you can trend things. However, but to aggregate the data and do the analytics, especially if you have many buildings with different kind of control systems that do not talk to each other, so you have to have some other programs that can draw information from those energy management systems and then do the analytics.
Yeah, just I guess from my perspective, this is one of the things that I've been searching for some time, but now, you know, I need to do it more seriously. But to answer your question, you know, to me it's really financial. That's the motivation. It's really financial, because if I am able to have my HVAC systems, my lighting systems, and my submeters integrated into a single platform, and I can see in real time what is happening. I can compare what happens when the HVAC system turns on, when the lighting system turns on, or when it turns off. I can see the results. I know where to take action, where to make changes in the way that the systems operate. And I can do it, you know, by analyzing the history, and I can do it interactively. I can do it when it's happening. So if I have sub-meters that monitor my power on a real-time basis, second by second, I can calculate the rate of rise of the demand, and I can take action to mitigate that. That's what I can do, and that's where the county's goals are.
Big data, I think, Kim answers your question. Big data. 100,000 control surfaces, a 250,000 control surfaces. People in the business will tell you, lost that battle before it begins. But if you have a dashboard that you can interact with and you see something wrong and you can sense something about and you can check that valve or you can manually change it, then it's something you can act on. So the plan do check out. But I think we're at a point where analytics are far more sophisticated than the building automation controls that we have in place, which are also more sophisticated than some of the mechanicals that are still in these older buildings.
Thank you. Well, I want to thank you all so much for being on this panel. It's so helpful to have your real world experiences, and it really shows us there are so many more questions about this and more information that we all are needing. So thank you all for coming out today. And